we had Reaver Music Writing Service first. Now, Brian and I were Brian first.
Now, Brian Holland, like Sam Cooke, he could sound like Little Willie John, he could sound like Jackie Wilson, all this. So this is what impressed me about Brian.
I came to Berry and said, hey, I want to talk with Brian Burt, which used his whole name. A lot of people didn't even know what the Burt was. I could have had it Real Brian. And I intentionally put Brian because I was not that type of fella. This is how we came up with things like that. And we were the first producers at Motown, other than Berry. You know, actually, I guess I really was his right-hand man. But it was really like he more or less looked at Smokey as his sort of right-hand man. So I guess I was his left-hand man. And little did I know that none of these people had known Berry much more than maybe a month or so longer than I had. And Ray had just took her a spot. You know, now Ray was good now. I mean, she's a good musician. She's really a great technician. I mean, technically, she's a good musician. But she has a great ear. She has a very decent voice. More better than decent. Well, we were the Raver voices.
What happened to Gwen?
Gwen, she just sort of dropped out.
Please, please help me. Somebody, please, please help me. My baby's leaving me, and I'm in misery. Somebody send her back to me. 'Cause
I was Motown, the Motown sound. I mean, I'm saying this only because I was the engineer. I was the person who turned the EQ, and I wouldn't start recording until it sounded like I wanted it to sound. The only time in the studio with me in the control room with me would be Berry, and Berry would be very seldom in the control room. He'd start all out on the floor. I'd start putting the sound together, okay? Then he'd come in, then he'd start to mess around with the sound, then he'd go back out on the floor, then I'd put it back. I bought 4 pots with the same specification, came back, got a cigar box, and made a 4 mic mixer. And I started to record rehearsals on a Bell and Howell tape recorder. We'd go down to United Sound and record. We'd come back, and we'd only have 7.5-inch tapes because that's all we could play. We couldn't play 15-inch tapes. We'd have 7.5 copies. I had started recording the rehearsals so well that we got the rehearsal tapes confused with the 7.5 copies of the masters that were being cut at United Sound. And I kept telling Berry, I could do this, man. Then we started to go down to a guy named Bristol Bryant who had a studio in his basement. We recorded a few things down there. We ended up buying Bristol's equipment because I kept telling Berry, I can do this, man. I can do what those guys are doing. And I tried to show him by building this little mixer and doing it with the tape recorder. So he finally bought this equipment. Well, I didn't know anything about the Fairchild. It was a Fairchild board. I didn't know anything about that stuff. It was a little too sophisticated for me. So started to put the studio together. And every evening, when Ron would leave, he would break things down so that nothing could be done when he wasn't there. I told Berry, not to worry, I got a mop and a broom. And I was mopping the studio. I was mopping the control room all the time, watching Ron. And Ron left one day, and when Ron left that day, I got up under the board and put those wires and stuff back together. So Berry, come on. And that was Ron Malo's days. That was it.
intimidation loomed through the room. And when Smokey Robinson came in, so I said, well, what the hell can I do? So I stopped everything. Smokey, yay! You know, Smokey said, hey, man, you know. He said, where I know you from, man? I said, Cardone Center, the Chan.
Oh, man, Bateman, this guy is bad.
But I used to sing with Smokey. We were the Chimes.
Trust in me, and you won't be sorry. Treat me right, and I'll never make you cry.
I said I had a great deal to do with setting up the studio on the boulevard. Okay, well, you see what I mean when I say setting up the studio on the boulevard. This other guy really started to set the equipment up, and before he was ever really finished, we had never cut anything. We had never really cut anything. The first hit record I cut, you know, was after I started recording, and that was Money. Money was the very first hit record that was cut there. We had cut things before, but we had never released anything that was anything. But, you know, this was the thing. And then once we got technical engineers to come in, I fought with those guys for the longest because they wanted to change everything. And I was satisfied with, well, we're getting hits. Once they first started to change things, that this guy was telling me, well, we're putting in these new Bozak speakers, the new sound system, and we're putting in this and we're putting in that, and everything's going to be that much greater. I said, man, it doesn't sound as good. Oh, yeah, it's got to sound better. Because the equipment, they use the test equipment. I said, no highs. All the highs are gone. I said, nothing but boom. And we love bottom. But I said, well, there is no chick, chick, chick. We need some chick, 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 too. And we argued up and down.
Mike McLean, really, he's the one who's really responsible for me quitting, because he and I had differences because, like I said, he was trying to bring in new stuff, and we needed to grow. I'm not trying to say that we didn't need to grow, but I felt like this. Until I can hear something better than what we had, then what we've got is good enough. And after a while, they eventually did get it together, and it did sound a little better and different things. And this is the guy who built the first 8 multi-track machine. When I left Motown, we were still cutting 2 tracks. All of those Please Be Supposed to, Do You Love Me, Money, Shop Around, all those things were cut 2 tracks. I hated it when we added another track. They started to say, oh, we can do it later. We can mix it later. Let's get the mix now. You know, I mean, let's bring it up now. I had just gotten used to it. When we finished a session, the record was ready. All except maybe we might speed it up a little bit, or we might make the middle the front. But as far as like the record being balanced, everything was balanced. Everything was mixed. You know, very so. Yeah, we used to have mixing sessions. That's very. It wasn't shit to mix once we got through with the session. You know. Where, and I told him, I said, you can say what you want to say. I said, I'm the baddest son of a bitch on the planet with a razor blade. And I knew that once you see things starting to progress, and you start to see that they're not turning out quite like they're supposed to turn out. It's supposed to be turned out where we were all going to share in this success and everything. And like I said, Sad Jones came about in an effort, Berry's effort to appease me. So now you're going to think that I'm crazy. Motown, I think, was intended for me. That's because it's a record by the Sad Jones. I went to Berry, and I go to Berry, said, look, man, I said, every time we could have put a record out, and you put a Miracles record out, I wasn't taking into consideration that the Miracles probably had better material. At that time, you know, when you're at that age and at that time, you're not looking at everything objectively, you know. I was accusing him of not pushing us and pushing the Miracles, which he probably really was. That's because when you send records out to a radio station or whatever it is, and they're all on the same label. So I said, well, hell, it looks like we need another label then. Then Motor City inspired Motown.
The Motor City, oh, that's the place I'm singing of. Hey, hey, the Motor City, oh, that's the place I'm singing of. Well, I've traveled around from town to town. That is where I met my love. They say down in the Southland, they've got some pretty girls down there. And also in the East, and also in the West, but I bet that neither one can compare with the Motor City. Oh, that's the place I'm singing of.
I brought Popcorn in because we were always looking for new musicians. Popcorn had a group called the Mohawks, and I brought Popcorn to Motown because, I mean, he was my top musician on my productions that I worked even closer with than I did Brian. And James Jameson came in with Popcorn's group. Another guy that came out of Popcorn's group that turned out to be a hell of a musician, Mike Terry. He was as good as Paul Reiser as far as I'm concerned. I didn't need James Davidson. I very seldom used him on my productions.
What, the Correc-Tone? Or?
I'm talking about at Motown. Oh, no, at Correc-Tone I used him. But I very seldom used those guys because Berry was always putting those guys on probation. And our thing had to be is we had to prove that there was only one monkey at Hitsville that could stop a show, and that one monkey was Berry Gordy. They'd never be able to tell me that I couldn't get a hit record if I didn't use them. I wanted to be that Robert Bateman could get a hit record. But I would use another bass player, and I'd use another drummer. That was a part of my competitiveness because, see, when I came along, I didn't have anybody to compete with. I didn't have Norman Whitfield to compete with. I didn't have Holland Dozier Holland to compete with. I didn't have Nicky Stevenson to compete with. Although those guys were there, they could compete with me. I competed with Berry. Everybody doesn't know, but I know some people who do know. And I know Popcorn knows. Whoever was available is who you use. Hey, you need another voice or you need somebody to clap your hand. If you happen to be at the studio and we start cutting a session and we need some hand clappers, hey man, come on. Here, take the tambourine and hit it like this. Or we used to do that on record. Then it's chains and then it's people on plywood stomping their feet, you know, like on Where Did Our Love Go and Baby Love. It's a funny thing, the way that things turned out. Norman Whitfield is the greatest phenomenon that I've experienced. You know, he was a part of, he Pop played Cones. With Popcorn. Yeah, no. Well, actually, he didn't really play. He was just he and Popcorn were friends. And Popcorn let him play the tambourine, you know. And this guy used to just be around the studio just with his nose up against the control room, just looking. All of a sudden, I had gone to New York before he came into prominence, late 62. Now, before Mike, these Bowles was the Berry man, the baritone man. See, our thing was, most of the stuff that we cut with a four-piece, initially a four-piece rhythm section, which is like bass, drum, guitar, piano. Then we started using two guitars. Then the thing was, okay, well, the very first record that we really cut, and that was a hit, had the baritone and the flute. Beans did the baritone during the basic session. When he got to the solo, he did the flute. But all the baritone did was, all he did was push the one, and accented the four, like one, two, three, four, right up. Look, this is who I was battling with. This is how I got the outstanding part on Mar Johnson's record. I was battling with the baritone. The baritone was trying to do that part. And I just took it. I said, shit. You know, I wasn't supposed to be doing that. And I just got on the mic and baritone. First of all, you gotta start with a great song. A great producer can produce a sound, and you can produce a record, but you're better off to start with a great song, because a great song will keep you making, you'll be making money 40 years later. Production goes one time, a song lives on. You look at money. You're taking great money down. Do you remember a song called What I Say? Girl with the riches on, you give to the birds that be. I need money, that's what I want, what I want. Sing it up, baby. Do you love me? Do you love me? That's all it is. You can't knock it. And if you're in doubt about anything, put the kick drum and the bass on 1 and 3. And put the snare on 2 and 4. And you go boom, jack, boom, jack, boom, jack, boom, jack, boom, boom, jack, boom, jack, boom, jack, boom, boom, jack, jack, boom, boom, jack. And you can't go wrong. If you got a great tune, hey, and if it's a fast tune, you go boom, jack, boom, jack, boom, boom, jack, boom, jack. Wilson Pickett was my ticket to New York. See, Pickett was quite a challenge. You know, like I said, everybody's got their own story, but I deemed myself responsible for Wilson's solo career. You know, he's quite a volatile fellow. You know, Robert Bateman, you know, I couldn't get a hit with him because I was too pop, you know, coming from out of Motown. You know, because Motown, we were not an R, I wouldn't consider us an R&B company. Only it got tagged R&B because we were black. What happened, and this is how I happened to leave Detroit. I was in Chicago at the time, listening to some Beatles material for an Abner. I thought, hey man, I think it's great. You know, and this is before it was ever released or anything. And I was listening to this stuff, and I was playing some other material for him. And he was really only interested in the Wilson Pickett materially, if you need me. So I had played some other things for him, and he didn't like them. So we broke for lunch. So when we broke for lunch, he was telling me, well, this tune, I can't remember what particular tune it was. It was something that we did that was a takeoff of something that Marvin Gaye had done. He said, well, see, it should have started like this, and then it should have gone here, and there's this. So we broke for lunch. So they had a little studio set up. So I took the tapes, got a razor blade, and I spliced the tape. But he said it should have been here, I put it there. So when they came back for lunch, I played this stuff again. He said, oh, see, why didn't you play this for me before?
Right.
And I told him, I said, well, it just, I forgot I had it. It was a couple of the same things that he had already heard.
Well, now you jump to the left, and you shake, 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 and then you slide to the right, and a shake happens.
Meanwhile, I call back and talk to Wilbur, and Wilbur tells me he sold the publishing to, if you need me, to Atlantic. I said, Wilbur, how could you sell the publishing and you're not the publisher? He says, you know, well, there's money for the writers too, you know, and of course I was a writer, you know, Sonny, myself, and Wilson, we were writers.
And I ended up just assigning the copyrights. I had already copyrighted the material. You know, and I've always felt like this, hey, I wrote that one, I would write another one.
Well, when I told Abner this, well, Abner, that's what he really wanted. He really wanted Pickett. I told him, you can still get Pickett. And I knew that, you know, he's interested in his own career. So he says, nah, man, we're not going to fight with Atlantic. They were going to cut it on Solomon Burke. And they did cut it on Solomon. And I said, I'll be damned if I'm going to give up my production just because we gave up the song. And I took Wilson's record back to New York because they wanted the record. Oh, yeah, we're going to put this out. I said, now the only thing now is that Solomon Burke is going to cover this record. Oh, no, you're not going to tell ABC. Oh, yeah, we love it, we love it. I said, now the only thing, Solomon Burke is going to have a cover on this record.
Oh,
I mean, I went all over. I went to all the majors first. And then I started to go to just all labels and everything.
Oh, wow. You know, yeah.
Nobody wanted to fight with Atlantic. Then I ran into Lloyd Price on the street, and they were just going into the business.
Hey, Bateman, yeah, we know you, yeah, from Detroit, yeah, man, you know, blah, blah, yeah.
Postman and all that stuff, you know, bam, bam. So we went up there, I played it.
Oh, wow.
You know, this jockey by the name of Magnificent Montague, I mean, the hottest thing. This thing is Burn, Baby, Burn. Hey, we went over the Bell Sound, and we had about 5 acetate stuff. Montague played that record back to back, like 8, 9, 10 times. Jerry Wexler tells me that he was in his office the next day, and the record came on, and he fell over backwards. And it was really a challenge that Wilson had put to me, is that I couldn't produce an R&B record. You know, I'm too pop. So I told him, I said, hey man, don't tell me what I can't do. You know, so I sit down and I had to start to think R&B. And the R&B that I could think of, which was still, I thought was pop, was Sam Cooke, but which was really more gospel. So I thought about Sam Cooke. You send me, change is gonna come. Then I just sit down with those chords, right, which is just a major minor, you know. And I had been taught from Ray. Ray was a big influence on me, too, and Berry. What we call the rah-rah, which is like 1, 6, 4, 5.
changes. Da 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 basic change, right? Do 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 do, or either do 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 do. That's a major minor. So that's what I sit down with. But if you need me, I thought about you send me you. So I said okay, but if you need me, you call me, pick up the phone, and. It started Wilson, and It's Too Late was the same thing, only I didn't have anything. He wrote It's Too Late. Sell the publishing. Of course, you're not the publisher. So that was a way for him to pick up. I think they gave him about $1,500 to $2,000. And the writers, I think we got about $1,000 a piece, you know, as an advance. So, you know, the dollars didn't seem too bad to me. But see, I didn't realize the value of publishing or anything else at that particular time. Back then, we're only paying musicians $5 a side. You understand? Let's say if you need me in those tunes, they only cost $25 or $30.
Somebody told me that the Supremes were backing Wilson on those two records.
No, the Andante. But they were popcorn. I don't know if it's anything you could document, but it leaves a bitter taste in Wilbur Golden's mouth. Dancing in the Street was called... It was not Dancing in the Street. Of course... The idea was done at Correc-Tone. I can't think of the name of it. But it was really done after I had left Correc-Tone. But that left a bitter taste in Golden's mouth. I had left Berry so many times. I mean, I could write a book about that. But usually either go back by just going back, or either I'd go back because he'd come and get me and bring me back. There's a guy named Mickey Stevens, very ambitious fellow. I used to sing with Mickey's brother. But, you know, it's a funny thing. Mickey, insidious. Is responsible for me not going back to Motown. Mickey Stevenson is who introduced me.
Mickey put you in touch with Wilbur.
Yeah, because he didn't want me to come back. Because all that shit that he was doing, that he ended up doing,
you would have done.
Yeah. After I had left Motown, I cut some stuff. I cut Fred Bridges. And I cut it on Wilson. I cut it on Fred first. Because it was released on a label out of New York. But it was cut here at a specialty recording. Danny Dallas. Yeah.
No more fumbling. on when I left my happy home. I was headed in the wrong direction, running all over town, acting like a clown, when I needed your love and affection.
Oh, baby, now weep
no more for me.
Oh, baby, weep
no more for me.
My
love, now
weep
no more for me.
Oh,
baby, cause you know I'm coming home. You know I should have been here.
See, this is what I'm saying. As far as like any chains of anything, first of all, nothing, everything that was cut. Now, you see, Berry puts himself down as producer, but the royalties hadn't really started to really roll in.
You thought you were going to get more money from Mr. Golden?
Oh, well, I mean, as far as like a salary, I did. No question about it. As much money as it turns out that they said that they started Barney Ailes off with, they started him off with $100 and a quarter. And Wilbur Golden started me off at $150 a week. That was a hell of a lot of money. He had another partner who was another number man. I can't think of his name. The studio on 12th Street, we were using a Crown, two-track Crown machine. Now, the studio on Grand River, I sort of designed the whole bit. You know, got the equipment and sort of set it up. I did the whole setup. I didn't feel like that we actually needed an Ampex necessarily. And I think the sound-wise, I think we proved that we had a commercial sound.
And we had a girls group. What was the girls group? Because the lead singer eventually went with the Elgins, Yvonne. But I can't think of the name of the group.
To donate.
Oh, okay. They had a thing I called Bad Boy, and he's got the devil in his heart. The Beatles ended up recording.
Marva Josie and Wilson Pickett were the catalyst for Wilbur Golden to go into the music business. Yeah, okay, singer, good looking girl. So Brent and Time were like sister label, and Wilbur sold the master to Bobby Shad, who had Time Records. And we also sold the masters to the Donays of the Donays. We sold that to him, but he put it out on Brent, evidently. Laura Johnson?
Laura, she's dead now, but Laura was like basically a jazz singer.
I also did, what's this girl's name?
Betty Levitt.
I also cut her record there. Her
what,
record
for Johnny May?
Yeah, her record was cut at the Correc-Tone. Gino is a coward. Okay, you heard me say I was the publisher. That means that it would be up to me to pay him, right? Now, this is how Wingate and I fell out. Ronnie is after me about his money. Okay, Wingate was a guy that he was a control type of person. He'd do a lot for you, and he would give you anything, but you couldn't ask him for too much. So the record had been out, and Ron kept asking me about, well, man, when am I going to get some money? I said, well, as soon as Wingate pays me. I'm trying to wait for him to pay me. So I went to him and, you know, hey man, blah, 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 blah. I told him, hey man, it's not me. You know, and he ended up giving Ronnie some money. but he was sort of through with me after I, all I did for you asking me this, and how come, you know, I ain't gonna pay you, and, you know, that's it, man. Yeah, that was the end of my relationship with him.
Sorry, treat me right, and I'll never make you cry, for I've been mistreated, and I've shed so many tears, oh, so
I don't know if you remember Misty by Loy Price. It was supposed to have been cut live at Small's Paradise, you know, but it was cut in the studio, and I made it like a live, you know, I overdubbed crowd noises and the whole thing. You know.
You never miss your water till your well goes dry. You never miss your baby till she says goodbye. I've been around the world so many times, and nowhere could I find a girl as sweet as the girl I had, the girl I left.
I started Luther Ingram. Luther Ingram and I are from the same hometown, Alton, Illinois. We usually tell people we're from St. Louis. Luther was
maybe about 3 or 4 years younger.
Okay, well, here, that's my label. This is Paul Ingram and Bateman. Paul, that was a girlfriend of mine.
Yeah.
We were sort of a team, and then Atlantic distributed this. See, it has my address. That's my family house. You know, yeah, my parents, well, they're dead. But I was living in New York at the time. Okay, I said we're from Illinois, but we're really from the St. Louis metropolitan area. I'd cut Luther, I'd send the record down, or take the record down to St. Louis. They'd break the record. Atlantic would pick up the distribution. But then once Atlantic picks up the distribution, they pull it from the distributor, who broke the records. Then the distributor evidently was powerful enough to say in that market, hey man, well, fuck him. I mean, you know, I break the record, then I, you know, but see, I didn't realize that I was forming a bad relationship, because I put a record out, he breaks the record starts to make a noise, then Atlantic distributor hears about the record. Oh, that's Bob Bateman's record. Hey, Bob. Yeah, this is Jerry. Yeah, man, you know. Distribute my records worldwide. You know, they're going to give me an advance. You know, they might give me $4,000 or $5,000 or something, you know, which is damn money. I mean, in the early 60s.
If it's all
recorded it in Detroit. I knew when I was done in New York. See, because we also had a record, Luther Ingram, on Smash. Luther Ingram was the original. Of course, I think Popcorn helped him on the production too. But because we did it for Redbird, we did it for Libra and Stolen.
You recorded that in New York?
Yeah.
With New York musicians?
New York musicians. But I'll tell you one thing. When I left Detroit, I had to learn to do things all over again. Because, see, when we were at Motown, and when we were especially at Motown, for that $5 a sound that we were paying those guys, hell, we could have them there all day long. Come back again tomorrow, give them another $5, and cut all day long. Once I went to New York, I got bound by the union. I had to supposedly cut 3 or 4 sides in 3 hours. And I'm used to cutting all day, cutting one song. But like I said, then I got tied up in a thing where I got a big union scale. And especially once I started to work at Capitol, Capitol had their own studios, had their own engineers. So there was a union. And here I am, I've been an engineer, but I don't know nothing about a union. I reach over here for one of the controls. I'm getting ready to pull a bass up. The guy grabs my hand. Hey, what are you getting ready to do here? I said, I'm getting ready to pull the bass up. Well, here, you signed the affidavit saying you authorized distortion. I mean, this is the way you record a guitar. I mean, you use a Shure 666. And I tell him, well, no, we don't use the Shure 666. Use the RCA 44. Oh, no, that's a Ribbit mic. We don't use those. I mean, we use whatever sounds good. This is what I'm saying. Like, stuff like the Wilson Pickett stuff, the Marvin Josie stuff, the stuff that you see on Cub and Time and stuff. Those records, like I said, they only cost $30 or $40 to cut. We weren't using but like a 4-piece rhythm section, maybe augmented with a couple of pieces. 6 pieces, $30. We'd sell a master, or at least a master, for $500. You know, then once I started to get really aware of it, then I got to the point where if I could at least get $1,000, and I'm having fun. It's like I'm not working. I'm having fun.
Master said.